الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له، ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، ونشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا وحبيبنا ومولانا محمدا عبده ورسوله، صلى الله تعالى عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه وبارك وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا. أما بعد، فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى بعد: أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ولا يغرنكم بالله الغرور. صدق الله العظيم وصدق رسوله النبي الحبيب الكريم، ونحن على ذلك لمن الشاهدين والشاكرين، والحمد لله رب العالمين. اللهم لك الحمد كما أنت أهله، فصل وسلم على سيدنا محمد كما أنت أهله، وافعل بنا كما أنت أهله، فإنك أهل التقوى وأهل المغفرة.
The end of last year concluded with the discussion regarding a figure which Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam described as Dajjal. And speaking about him, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned from the beginning of time, meaning the time of Nabi Adam alayhi salatu wasalam, till the end of time, meaning till the day of Qiyamah, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala will never create a fitna, a test, a figure who will be as fearful, forceful, effectful as Dajjal himself. And after we mentioned that how this Dajjal, how we should look at him, understand him, and how people have the perception that he will come at the end of time, and it will be a few people who will only see him. So we try to explain that the ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam hasn't shown that. Rather, it has shown that every single person should understand that in my own era, although I can't see the man himself, the jinn himself, but the work that this man is doing is all around me. If a fish is in the water and it understands that the fisherman is outside, then the fish will never ever bite. The problem comes the day the fish, while moving in the water, sees a lovely juicy worm. And the worm in the water, the way it wriggles, ask any fisherman, he will tell you he doesn't use dead bait. He will use live bait. And the way that worm will move, so when that baby fish will see that worm moving, he will get attracted. Like how a boy, when he will see a girl moving, a dead girl on the side of the road, you will never look at her and say, wow. It is when she moves. So every fisherman will make the wriggling, the worm that moves this way, that way. When baby fish will see it, mommy fish long ago had told baby fish, that my baby, the day you see a worm, don't bite. Because behind the worm there's a line, and the line is going out. And outside there is a very huge fisherman, which Hazrat Maulana Abdul Hamid Sahab Daman Barakatuh explained, that fisherman is just waiting for the one bite. And baby fish, he heard mommy's story, but because he thought it's just a story, so at that moment he forgot it all. When he saw the beautiful little worm, all the stories he had heard in his life now he went to one side. Because he had no yaqeen on it from the beginning. So the deception which he could not see, because the light of the sun was not going to show the line of the fisherman. Sometimes when the light shines and that line just shows in the water, the fish realizes, hey, a trick. But the fisherman is also a master. He makes the line such that even the sun will not hit it and it will make its reflection. Everything he does to keep the deception for that baby fish. Everything. So much so, even when he realizes the baby is biting, no fisherman pulls immediately. He says, give him time, let him enjoy. Until he comes and takes a nice bite. That's only when I will push. Pull. So he keeps it right till the end. The deception that we go through of the jal is exactly the same. You won't see it until the day when it is too late to see it. You will bite, and you will find nothing happening, but day by day we get caught up. Until we go very, very far away. Mummy had told baby fish that if that fisherman pulls, fishing stories, if that fisherman pulls, you will be immediately afflicted with a severe pain in the side of your mouth. Baby fish could never understand. And thereafter you will be taken for a long walk in the waters. You will be moving this way, something will be pulling you that way. You will be going that way in this world, like how a man gets problems. You will see him running every corner. In every place he'll find the door is closed. Running that way now, running that way. And he will understand, my death is coming. It is very, very soon. And how that fish now starts to panic. And at that moment, as that fish is moving, whatever mummy had told him in the past now starts going back in his mind. The reel starts, rewind. Mummy had told him that once you come out of the water, you won't be able to breathe. Your life is in water. The area out of that will now start suffocating you. And now you will feel himself being pulled to the top. He'll get more and more weaker. You will understand reality is now opening up, but it's too late. Mummy had told him, when you will come out, there'll be a huge monster, man. The size of man is like 50 fish. He could never understand, 50 fish. Someone who stands, something impossible. But as he comes out of the water, he sees man there. Mummy had told him, if he grabs you, the first thing that will hit you is his butcher knife. He will cut you in half and he sees the knife right there. As he's put now on that rock, and that knife is taken, then mummy had told him he's going to slit you in half, and he sees that knife coming for him. Hazrat Murana says that mummy would have told him that if it's going to be an Indian fisherman, he'll throw masala on you. And if it's an Arab, he'll cook you dry without any. So he sees that also. Everything is his. Everything. At that moment he says, ah, if only I had listened to mummy. That one bite I never took. But who will take the bite? Only that fish who doesn't see the fisherman. If the fisherman is seen, no matter how well he smiles at the fish, my dear, why don't you come over and take a bite? No fish is ever going to bite. The jal is that same, Mr. Fisherman. If ever he has to be in front of us and he says, I am God, even a man with weak iman will look at his ugly eye and say, if you are God, at least sort out your own face first. It was not going to be an imtihan if you could see the man himself. Ugly. The imtihan was going to be as long as he can be behind the scenes. A time will come when he will come out in his physical form, which the ahadith has spoken about. That will be a time when the Muslim ummah will be on a height. Hazrat Mehdi will be moving around the world for a period of about 7-8 years. The Muslims around the world will be coming up in jihad. Countries which had gone to the Western countries will be brought back into Islam. Islam, the flags of Islam will be lifting every place. The Christian armies will be destroyed. Now when there is no Christians left to support his mission, that will be the only time when Dajjal will make a physical appearance. Where he will see everything I had done is now going crashing to the ground. At that time it will happen physical. Before that, it will all be Dajjal. Dajjal means, if someone is able to beautify something in a manner that when you see it, the reality of it never comes to your mind. To such an extent, if someone points to it and says, this is stool, you will tell the man, have your head checked up. This is lovely, beautiful, tasty. That is Dajjal. To be able to beautify it so perfectly, that the man who says that this is filthy, the rest of the world will tell him you are a madman. Dajjal. Which Mawlana Ashraf Ali Thanvi rahimullah explained. That if a person makes stool, urine, he is not your best friend, your worst enemy. After going to the toilet, he gathers whatever came out. And he makes it into a nice cake shape. And on top of that cake, now he takes foil. It's very, very glossy foil. And he covers it nicely. And he puts a ribbon on top also. And then he writes, "To my beloved friend." And he comes and delivers it at your door with so much of care that even the crease must not come on that. Then a baby might run to it and say, "Daddy, how beautiful it is." But the father who knows who sent that present, that's my worst enemy, he will just start smelling that filth and he will hold his son back. "Don't touch that." Baby will say, "Daddy, it's so smart, I want to play with it." Daddy will have to hit the child, but he'll keep him away. Daddy will take that thing and throw it out of the house without even opening it. Just the mere smell will tell him, "Don't you dare open this." He says, this is Dajjal. That if you are able to beautify a filthy prostitute in such a manner that when she walks, a man who got a beautiful halal wife in his house, but he doesn't see her beauty and he says, "Hey, that's a girl, that's for me." Then you understand that that thing has been made now beautifully covered. Dajjal. A lifestyle which is filled with filth. And every person you phone him, that "I want to be like you." You finally get his phone number. "I got the guy. He's my fan. His picture is on my wall. I open my closet. There's his picture. At night I sleep, I'm thinking of him or her. In the morning I wake up, I look to see no one stole the picture. I feel happy to write his name on my t-shirt." Normally in certain countries where soccer players are worshipped. So we mentioned to those people, especially those young boys, when they come to the masjid, it's written on the skipper also. So he says, it's amazing that boy who plays soccer, he thinks if he has that soccer player's name written on his back, he'll be able to kick the ball more straight. That boy is Muhammad Ahmed, but his father will be ready to call him the name of a non-Muslim. That same boy, if I had to go up to him and said, "Hey, you dog," the father will become angry with me. But a dog in the end of the day is going to become sand. And all finished. That same boy, that father, however, if I call the boy by the name of a kafir soccer player, the father will smile and say thanks. That is that Dajjal. A lifestyle which is made so appealing, so appealing. Finally, that young boy gets that man's telephone number. And his heart is just wants to come out. "I'll finally speak to the man who got everything. The man whose one word will make me happy." And he phones finally and someone answers, "Can I speak to Mr. So-and-so? He committed suicide yesterday." He got no happiness in his life one bit. He committed suicide yesterday and you thought you will speak to him, you will become the happiest man in the world. It's Carnegie. David Carnegie, most likely his name is. He's a person who was known as a comedian, as a person who could talk. And he could make everyone who was sad happy. So many non-Muslims started reading his books. Many Muslims began reading his books. Because the purpose of the books was how to make everyone feel welcome, happy. What books we have nowadays, "Don't Be Sad." So those books, the idea was taken from this Dale Carnegie. So in one of the books, the author is writing that all my life I was impressed by the books of Dale Carnegie. And I used to, whatever books he would write, I would get it and look at his principles that he would teach. How to be happy, don't be sad. And how to make everyone happy. And he was a master. Every place he would sit, people would laugh and they would go away. That man, he knows how to take away all our problems. So the author writes of one book that so many years amazed with Mr. Dale Carnegie. And then one day I read that Mr. Dale Carnegie himself had committed suicide. He says, on that day I understood what a dhoka this world is, deception. The man who everyone else thought he will make us happy, what he committed suicide for? Because there was no happiness in his own life. But that deception, that gloss that is put around, that is called Dajjal, the Dajjaliyat. And that all the ulama have always mentioned, we are living in the fitna of Dajjal. Fitna is an imtihan, a test. Every principal of a madrasa can't come and take the imtihan of every student. Come, you tell me your fa'ala, fa'ala, gardan. You tell me what's in Usul al-Shashi. You tell me Nur al-Anwar. It's not going to be possible. There won't be time for it. What he does, however, he appoints different people to take imtihanat. Some imtihan, mumtahins will be the soft mumtahin. Everyone will look, see who the mumtahin is, very happy. And some will be the hard ones. Dajjal has been made amongst the hardest of all. But who has put him in charge? Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, where he made shaitan and he gave him what shaitan wanted for imtihan. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala gave Dajjal whatever power Dajjal wanted for imtihan. He is a jinn like shaitan, but he has been blessed with other things which the normal shaitan hasn't got also. And he has been told, now start preparing your imtihanat. And people have to write this paper. This paper is an imtihan of Dajjal. Dajjal means doka, deception. This imtihan you will write. Every day you will walk out of the masjid. Then the imtihan will start. During the month of Ramadan, normally every person becomes pious. Which we see, and everyone normally in Bayanat mentioned, this is a month for Ibadah, and it is a month for Ibadah. But because all our people think that the month of Ramadan is a month only for Ibadah, and there is no other purpose behind it, a main purpose. So in the month of Ramadan, a boy will make a whole khatam. He'll be very happy. Somebody else might make 5 paras a day. I made 5 khatams. That girl is making so much. The boy is making so much. Last 10 days he's sitting in i'tikaf. Lot has been done. Lot. But because there was no purpose behind that allot, that what is this allot going to do for you? لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ Allah tabarak wa ta'ala said, Ramadan has come to teach you how when you see that evil, you are able to pull back. لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ So in the month of Ramadan, there was meat in that fridge. There was lovely dessert and faluda. You walked inside, your mother was not there, you were thirsty. And you knew that every day after Maghrib, I got no shock for this food. Because I have to read Taraweeh. A boy who reads Taraweeh, he'll never eat Maghrib time. He got that worry. But that faluda during the day, there's no one around. Very few will be the one who will take a spoon and say, no one is looking and eat it. Why? He will say, I don't want to spoil my fast. He will go in the toilet where now no one but the jinnat perhaps may be able to see him. And in every toilet there's water. He's very thirsty, he can just take little water and put it in his mouth and at least he'll be happy. But he won't do it. Why? I don't want to spoil my fast. That same man is married, his wife is so beautiful. He will walk in the house but he will make ghadda basar, he will look down. Because he will know if I go in the kitchen, my whole fast will go away. Very beautiful wife, just got married. He will protect himself. He will stay the whole day in the masjid. Why? I don't want to spoil my fast. Everything of that day will be, I don't want to spoil. Someone comes up to him and wants to fight with him. He woke up earlier than normal, so you say he woke up on the wrong side of the bed. He's supposed to be irritated. He is hungry, he's not getting his food. He is supposed to be angry. But when that man comes to irritate him, he tells that man, you know, I'm fasting. Which comes in the hadith, inni sa'im. I am fasting, my friend, don't interfere with me, go away. All very good. But one thing he never understood is that Ramadan is not the imtihan. Ramadan is preparation for the imtihan. So what he thought I'm writing the exam at the moment. So when the man came and said something that irritated him and he told the man, go away, he was very happy that I passed the exam. I never spoil my fast. He walked past his wife in the kitchen. He never looked at her with an eye of desire. He was happy. He never eat. He was happy. Why? He thought I'm writing the exam. He never understood Ramadan is only preparation for the exam that is coming. Had he known that day, he would have understood today how I managed to tell the person, my friend, I'm fasting. Tomorrow after Ramadan, I'll have to tell that same man, my friend, I don't want to make Allah angry. Rather just leave me. And today when I walk past my wife and I never noticed her, tomorrow I must be able to walk past the Susan and Mary and all this other filth that is around. And I must act as though I never noticed them. But he never understood that. That father who knows the exam is coming very, very soon. 1 month before the exam, he tells his son, I have booked you out in a place which is far from all your friends. No mummy to trouble, no daddy to trouble, no small child to trouble. You must just study, study, study. And after 1 month, the exam is going to start. So that boy every day is studying, going rattling, but he knows I'm not writing the exam, I'm only preparing. The second day he goes over the same question again and he goes on to question number two, question number three. On the 30th day he's not thrilled that tomorrow is holiday. He understands tomorrow is exam. So again he's checking up, When Ramadan comes, it is Allah's time to say to you, oh my servant, a big exam is coming, big. I'm giving you 30 days to prepare for it. During that 30 days, shaitan also is gone. Your nafs also is weak. Food and water is one side. You got no worries, no tension. Last 10 days come in the masjid, you even leave your wife one side. Now you are only farigh for the imtihan preparation. But because everyone thinks that I am writing the exam, so our condition in Ramadan is when the 25th, 26th, 27th is coming, then we think now holiday is coming after Ramadan. Like I'm in a cell and the cell is going to be open after Ramadan, I'm going to be free. So what will happen, which Mulana Jalaluddin Rumi Rahimullah said, that a king told his ministers, look at the cats I have trained. 12 cats can stand on 2 paws and 2 paws in the air and a candle on their nose. And I'll light every candle and we'll have dinner in front of the cats. But no cat will dare to move. I have trained him so well. Everyone amazed. One clever minister says, king, can I test your cats? King was very happy. No problem. Imtihan is something that shows the quality of everyone. The next day he walks in with a small bag. In the bag there's a small rat, which Hazrat Maulana explains that the whiskers of the cat is like antenna. So as that man walks in, he goes, ting. He says, now they started picking up. There's a frequency coming. That something's happening. But every cat is scared now. Must I make the first move? So his tail starts moving. Now his ears are moving. Now the whiskers are moving. And as soon as baby rat jumps, then he says, 12 years of training goes one shot down the drain. The king is screaming, where are you all going? Where are you all going? The cats are gone. They're not worried of the candle, of the mess. They are worried of the rat. He says, the imtihan of the cat is with the rat. The imtihan of the cat is not with the ministers. The imtihan of every one of us can't be in Ramadan because there's no shaitan. Our imtihan starts after Ramadan. But what happens on the day of Eid, the man forgot, hey, I'm writing an exam paper today. So on that day you will see boys and girls will get together at different lakes. And the girl will be telling the boy, you know, I made 6 khatams of Quran. He says, wow. Then the whole exam finished. Whole exam. Day and day, that one day where the shaitan was happy, he's coming out. Our shaitans came out. And 30 days of preparation went down one shot. Why? Because in Ramadan we thought we are writing the exam. We never knew we were preparing for the exam. We are waiting for our holiday. Our holiday will come the day our eyes will close. Which ulama would always mention, if you live your life like Ramadan, your death will come like Eid. It will be a happy day to die. You will know I passed. That's your holiday. Until then, however, an exam will be out in the world. The exam will be as soon as we leave the masjid. You will go into the rooms. You will go to your house. You will put on, before it would be the... You will go to the cinema. That was the fitna of the time. Thereafter, they brought the cinema into the houses. So man will be watching TV in his house. Thereafter they did even better than that. They brought the whole TV in his pocket. And now wherever he is moving, he got that phone in front of him. He will never be bored the rest of his life. And it doesn't cost anything. Before you would pay a lot to make one call overseas. And if you had to make that call on a cell phone, you have to be a very rich man. Now to phone overseas has become a free thing. The more expensive the phone is, more smarter, when normally you're supposed to pay more for it, you will now start paying less for it. And the calls will be cheaper. And you will be very thrilled that, see what this can do for me. But that man who got that whole television in his pocket, ask him, how much Quran do you read? Because he's never ever bored anymore, so there's no time for Quran. Do you ever make dhikrullah when you are free? He's never free. Because whenever he's free, he can put on immediately his business, check up his emails, go Go onto his own file and see how many people have sent him messages and he'll start answering. That man will never be bored. Why? Because the whole entertainment is now moving with him. He doesn't need anything more now. One friend of ours, he explained that they had a meeting with the cell phone companies. May Allah tabarak ta'ala make the zamana never come. But when they had this meeting with the cell phone company, Vodacom, then one of the main people in charge is telling them that 20 years ago, if I had told you what you are looking at today is going to happen, no one of you would have believed me. He's telling the people. They are all working now for Vodacom. So he says, not one of you would have believed me 20 years ago. Because it has gone so fast that 20 years ago, if you told someone in front of you will be your entire business, your bank, your house, you will be able to see in another country, you will be able to see your brother going for Hajj, you will see everything and it will all be here. It was something impossible. Just to be able to say your car will drive and it will tell you turn here, how will the car know where to turn? It was something impossible, but when it happened and everyone just took it like normal. He says 20 years time. He's telling them, or maybe he said 10 years, I don't know exactly what, may Allah Pak make it fail, but he's saying in 10 years time you all will see certain things which if I tell you today you will never believe me. And he says, example, one of those things is that how today we can give a phone where you press a button and you can see everything. That same chip, we want to have it installed into the hand of man, which will work directly with his brain. So there will be no need for holding a phone. If he wishes to check up his bank account, all he has to do is close his eyes. I don't know how he'll press maybe one button here and everything will come. Whether it will happen in 10 years or not, nothing is impossible. But nothing is impossible to control the heart of man, the whole computer. So my small brother was very sharp. He asked the man, then, because this boy is becoming a hafiz of Quran. He says, I don't think there's a need for you to worry about your hifz anymore. Because when you go on the musalla for tarawih, all you have to do is just press the right para. And I told him, you just press play and the imam of the haram will read through your mouth also. But what and what these people want to do with our bodies? What and what they got in mind? To take over. So that what was cinema, which went to television, which went to phone. And as it starts going better and better, everyone starts thinking I'm getting more and more advanced. But every advancement is another worm that is coming in the water. And how much are you going to bite? When is the fisherman going to pull? And how many have already bitten? And how many will continue biting? Hazrat Murana Abdul Hamid Sahib Damar Barakatuh, he gives an example of this Dajjal, Doka. That you will see it, it will look so nice. And you will say, I want that lifestyle. But the day that lifestyle comes to you, at that day when your eyes will close, you will cry. So very quickly he mentions a man is standing on a platform. The train is going past. He sees first class, a man is sitting there and a waitress is taking his order. He's in first class, the aircon, everything working. He says, what a lucky man this guy, traveling first class. And as first class goes, second, third, you get last class. Last class is that class where someone was standing on the side and he told the man, you know, I got no money. The man said, just jump on. Hold on for dear life. If you reach to the next station, Mubarak to you. So he put his bags and he's holding. There's no aircon because there's no doors. The wind is just coming and going. And there is flies all over and he's perspiring. And he looks at that man and he says, hey. If he's a man far from deen, I'm sure you'll say, this must be some Maulvi. Only he will travel in last class. And he thinks, if only I can be like that man. And Allah save me from being like this person. Hazrat Murana says, that is a Dajjal, Dajjal. He has shown you two lifestyles and you already made a decision that he is successful, he is not. He says, but the day your eyes close, you will be taken into the train. And when you go in the train, you will first run to first class to tell the man, can I eat with you? When you come there, you will see the food is still not touched. The man is looking blank. You will say to him, such lovely food. Why don't you eat and rest? This man will say that actually, or he won't talk, the woman will have to talk, he's dumb. The woman will say that this man has been convicted for murder. He is being sent now for his death sentence, for his punishment. He will be executed. As the train is going, we have given him his last meal, whatever his last desire is, we have been told to see to it. When he comes there, the police will be waiting. They are going to take him for his execution. For this poor man, every movement of the wheel is bringing him 1 second closer to his death, to his destruction, to meeting his final. You think that man will ever be happy? But that Dajjal will make you think, I want to be like that man. And you will see another man who has nothing in the world. You will go to help him now to hold his bags. And you will tell him, can't I give you some money to buy a ticket? And you will see him smiling. You will be amazed. You can smile in this condition. He will say, I have come from a very far country. So many years I spent writing letters to my family. All the work is finished now. Now my mother has told me, son, come home now. You have sent enough for us. We have built a lovely house with all your efforts. He says, whatever little I had, I converted it, I bought presents, I got hardly anything, I just managed to get a ticket to come. All my money is finished because all has been sent over. He says, but I know as soon as the train is coming to its stop, my whole family is to meet me. They will take my bags, they will change my clothing, I will have a shower. Tonight I will meet all my friends. He says, every movement of the wheel is bringing me closer to my happiness. Why should I not be smiling? So that is the life of a man of Iman. But the Dajjal around him, the disguise, will never ever make you think, I want to be like that man. And the other one is the life of the people who we see on magazines, on the television, on the billboards. And everyone says, I wish I can kick like him. I wish I can bowl like him, bet like him, sing like him, drive like him. I wish I can be him. And the day Allah Tabarak Ta'ala gives you the chance to see what his condition is going to be, then you will say, if Allah never have mercy on me, I would have been in his position today. So this is Dajjal that we are speaking about. May Allah Tabarak Ta'ala bless us all, that before our eyes close, we can start making correct decisions. We can see through that foil, and we can see what's on the inside of the foil. Wa akhiru da'wana.